Welcome, a very warm welcome to the English Bookshop and to our first annual reading with Scottish authors. There's a long story to this reading that goes back years. It starts with Christer and I reading the Karen Campbells and the Helen Fitzgeralds books, and then I started going to Glasgow in January every year for some peculiar reason, and then I ran into Karen, almost serendipitously, really. And we became friends, and then she suggested that perhaps they could come over and do a signing, and I thought, Kulturnatten is just perfect, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And so here they are. Karen Campbell has written four novels that are all about police in Glasgow, in the city of Glasgow. They're not traditional crime novels in the sense, in the usual sense of the word, but they are novels set in the world of the police. And they're absolutely captivating, beautifully written, and some very strong characters. Some of my favorite books, actually. So please welcome Karen Campbell, all the way from Glasgow. And we're very happy to have another special guest here to do the interview. But we're going to start with Karen, and she's going to read a piece from one of her novels. And then Karina Burman is going to interview Karen for a little bit. Karina Burman is another Karen Campbell fan, I might say, truthfully. And then after that, we'll be open for questions and answers. Not me particularly, but Karen. And then Helen will come on with Helena, and then we'll do the same thing again. And afterwards, after both authors have been on, we'll do a signing session for anyone who wants to pick up some copies of their books. And there's plenty of that. That will be down at the end of the room. So again, a very warm welcome. I'm glad so many people could come today. It's a beautiful day for a culture night. I think the best one ever. And without further ado, Karen Campbell.
Thank you. Can everyone hear me okay? Is this loud enough? A bit quiet? That better? Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I was going to read from my second book, After the Fire. Just before I do that, I'd just like to thank Jan and his family and his friends and all the team in the bookshop for being so welcoming and hospitable for Helen and I. We've had a fantastic time. First time either of us have been to Scandinavia, and the sun's Sean and everything, it's just been lovely, so thank you very much for your hospitality. I've written four books about the police, as Jan said, and I sort of fell into writing these books by accident. I used to be a police officer in Glasgow, and that's why I've chosen to write about the police, and I think it's also why I've chosen particularly not to write traditional crime sort of detective things. I was a uniformed officer, I was never in the CID, which is the plainclothes detectives. And I always felt, both in real life and in fiction, that detectives, they get too much praise. In actual fact, I feel it's the uniformed officer that has the hardest job in the police. They're the ones who have no preparation. When the detective is called, there's already been an incident, there's been something that they can prepare mentally on the way for, and they can start to think about how they're going to, you know, work their strategy. For a uniformed officer who's told to go to a disturbance, could be anything behind the door. They knock on the door, could be a fight between man and wife, it could be a baby crying in a cot, it could be a drugs den. You have no idea, it could be somebody with a shotgun. And from that point of view, I felt I wanted to try and show that side of policing. And the maybe the less glamorous side, the less exciting side, but I feel the most important job, which is being all things to everybody to some degree. The book I'm going to read from is my second novel. They are not really a series, they're standalones. You can read them independently. And I chose this one because I think it's probably the easiest book just to drop into if you don't know the characters. All you need to know about this book is the hero is a guy called Jamie, who is a police officer who's become a firearms officer. In Scotland, police are not armed routinely. It's only about 3% of officers become firearms officers, and you volunteer to do that. You don't get paid extra money, and you have to undergo a lot of training, psychological training as well as actual training in shooting. And it's a job that is a difficult one to do, and not many people actually want to do it. And a lot of police in Britain don't want to carry guns for many reasons. And in this book, right on the first chapter, you know that Jamie is going to prison because he shot somebody, and it turns out that they weren't armed. And I wanted to look at how one minute you can be a lawmaker and the next minute you're a lawbreaker, and it's not a malicious thing that you've done. You think you've done the right thing. He shoots someone who's unarmed, who they thought was going to pose a threat, and turns out that they don't. And it ends up with Jamie, the police officer, being charged with murder. And you might think, well, there's no point in reading the book now. She's just told me the whole story. What a waste of time. I'm away. And that was my dilemma when I wrote this book too. I thought, I want to write about this. I want to write about how his family are affected. I want to write about what happens afterwards, because he ends up in prison. Where do I have the dramatic tension happening in the book? Because if the story is leading up to a court case, and you get to half of the book, and you're at the court case, and you see the other half, you think, it's not going to end well, is it? You know that there's bad stuff coming. So I got around that by splitting the book in two. And I begin the book with Jamie in prison, so you know this is as bad as it gets. And then the book is in two halves, so in the first half it leads up to what happened to him being in prison, how did that arise, and then the second half of the book is about what happens afterwards. Does he survive? How does a policeman survive in jail when most of the people in jail want to kill him? What happens to his family, who haven't done anything wrong, but they're serving a sentence also. Their friends and family turn against them, they have no money coming in, they have to move. And I just thought it was an interesting thing to explore. So the piece I'm going to read, all you need to know is that there's been a call to the police that they think a gun has been discharged. So the firearms officers are called. Jamie is new to firearms. This is his first live incident. He's with another colleague called Jinky Robertson. And the only other person in this scene that you need to be aware of is an inspector called Coltrane, who I met a few of these people in the police. I was a student before I joined the police, so I have nothing against graduates, but we have a graduate programme in the police which I didn't take part in, but people join and with very little experience they get promoted quite quickly, and so this is my little dig at that, because Coltrane is one of these bosses who thinks he knows what he's doing, but doesn't really. You'll hear some radio traffic, so I won't do different voices, but if you get a bit confused, I'm trying to simulate the fact that they're on the radio and other people are talking over them because other incidents are happening at the same time. They're at a tenement in Glasgow, and which is a block of flats, and there's been shooting from the second floor, or a noise of possibly shooting. Jamie's down at the front. A hand struck glass and the open pane shattered, raining shards. Two or maybe more arms flailing at the window in a twist of curtain, then they disappeared. Jamie's heart leaping from his chest, battering to get out, falling back in. Still his finger never left the curving edge of the trigger, insinuating his flesh with its metal grin. Grim, set, waiting. What's going on? Like a wasp in his earpiece. Inspector Coltrane again. What can you see, Worth? Nothing. Robertson, the kitchen light's gone out. Right, I want you to get in close to the house. Sir, said Jamie, I strongly advise against that. Bloody sweat again, it was dripping in his eyes. There's people in that building, Worth, and there's people outside, sir. He could taste it in his mouth like tears. And what if she runs out with all guns blazing? Controlled Inspector Coltrane, have details on another male sometimes residing at the same address. Robertson to Worth. Jamie, can you see her? Negative, no movement at the front. Have Inspector Coltrane to Worth, controlled to Worth, Inspector controlled to Coltrane. Sweat was nipping at his eyes. To the night shift superintendent, ETA 10 minutes. Roger, sir, controlled to Constables Worth and Robertson. Robertson to Worth, Jamie, I can Worth to Robertson. What was that, Jinky? Negative, Alpha Mite 1, no further assistance. Golf to 474, can you attend a report of a noisy party at 9 Sefton Street? Robertson to control, can you put us on a separate radio channel? We can, eh? Robertson to Worth. Jamie, I can see her. She's running down the stairs. She's just past the landing. Jamie! Inspector Coltrane to Worth, get ready. She's coming out. Get bloody ready. Licking the moisture from his upper lip. Rocking on his heels. Stay still. Cushioning the butt against the recoil. Remember to shout. Remember to wait. Remember your children that you'll never see grow. Felt his bowels slip. Coltrane was screaming in his ear, but he couldn't hear the words. Just moans as his vision narrowed like the tunnelling on the range. just you and the target, and you and the target, and the gun and the target, and your finger, it's moving, it's a target, and the whining's growing louder, and there's nothing else but you and the door through which she runs. And she raises her arms, so you lift and you aim, and they're screaming at you from another place, but they're not here, and you are. And you feel your finger squeezing as the air freezes. The air is stopping, and you are watching this, up in the tree with the flapping pigeons. 20 minutes in a taxi would take you back to your own house, and you swoop down with a silent gasp. I don't want to die so close to home. But it's too late. He hears a bang, a huge bang that comes from inside his trembling finger. And as he's thinking, she's falling over backwards, slow, so slow. If he runs, he could catch her and break her fall. All he can hear are her movements, though his helmet's deadening. He can hear the rustle of her anorak as it flaps out to catch the smoke that's everywhere. White pillows spilling like vomit are her pillow as she lands, then bounces once, like on a trampoline or in a bad movie where they drag it out. Then the sweat's in his eyes again, so he can't see his legs, which are trying to walk on their own. They spasm with his hands as he stumbles forward to where she sprawls. Dirty blonde hair spread in a puddle that's coming from her chest. There's a pack, he's got a pack somewhere with bandages and lint, but he can only find a hanky stuffed up his sleeve. And he tries to stem the flow that's belching and spreading, and someone is screaming at him to get back, get back. And how he wishes that he could. I'm then going to read from the start of the next chapter. We meet Jamie's wife. They're going on holiday this night, and Jamie's supposed to have got away early from work, and Kath is basically waiting at home for him. They have two young children who are also very excited about going on holiday, and are getting a bit agitated because they might miss their plane. Kath couldn't get the button through in her cuff. It was a stupid thing, shaped in a thin metal link, needing two hands to work it through the slit. Jamie always did it for her, but she'd given up waiting. At this rate, Kath would be driving the kids to the airport herself. Where the hell was he? They should be leaving the house in 20 minutes, and he still wasn't home. You're cutting it fine, boy. She glowered at his shorts. Still damp. She tried spinning them in the microwave for 5 minutes. Now they were warm and damp, with a wee hint of defrosting prawn. Ailey lolled on the couch, one arm round her toy-lined shoulders. She had on her new striped sundress and a straw hat with cherries. Oi, miss, Kath patted her on the arm. Don't you go back to sleep. I'm not. Ailey raised her Barbie sunglasses. Look, mummy, I'm awake. Good girl. Now, wouldn't you rather wear this nice baseball cap? The one they sent in your travel pack? Ailey looked at the blue logo on the front. It's for boys, she said firmly. Give it to Dan Pants. Daniel's got his own. Daniel was wearing his hat on his foot, leg poised mid-air toward his mouth like a cat about to groom. Ha! He agreed. The fruity hat Ailey wore was hideous. It was a granny gift. Okay, Kath patted the plush toy her daughter was clasping. Well, Lionel's a boy and he'll need a hat, so will we take it for him? He has a mane, mummy, Ailey sighed. Arr, screeched Daniel, dropping his hat and tugging at the line. Leave him, screamed Ailey, you hurted his hair. She thrust one palm against Daniel's chest, pushing him to fall on his padded nappy bum. Enough, shouted Kath. If you two don't behave, we'll not be going anywhere. Both kids began to cry. Well, I'll phone the aeroplane man now and say we're not coming. No, wailed Ailey. Daniel licked the snot from his nose. I want Lionel, he sobbed. Well, you can't have him, he's Ailey's. Kath's open cuff wiped against his nose. Shit. Oh, mummy, you swore. Kath glanced at the clock on the breakfast telly. 15 minutes or they'd miss their check-in. Where the hell was he? I just want to skip to the end of this chapter. The kids and Kath have fallen asleep. Jamie's still not arrived. In the interim, Kath has managed to get the button through in her blouse, but she's chipped her tooth by pulling it, so her mouth is looping, as we say in Glasgow. And she's heard on the television news that there's been a shooting incident in Glasgow. She's thinking, no, can't possibly be anything to do with Jamie. He's late, something else has happened, but, you know, she's been worried, so she's asleep. Kath raised her head, half asleep, felt his shadow at the front door, moved to the hall and watched him stand there, head pressed on glass. But she didn't open it. The kids had fallen asleep on the couch, their wee fat feet in brand new sandals. They were too late now, too late for this flight. They looked so peaceful, the kids. Just stay out. If she ran and yelled, where the hell have you been at him? Would that exercise what was coming in? then Gerard's catering. Jamie, at last, you do realise we've missed the bloody... His skin was wet, grey, eyes narrow, no movement, no sight. And she didn't want to see it. It was her husband, and it was not. It was some pathetic shade of him, stretching out with flailing fingers to find the light switch for their gloomy hole. Jamie, she moved forward, are you okay? I mean, clearly, obviously, he was not, but that's what you said to stop the silence and keep the kettle boiling. She'd have moved his jacket. You're soaking. Where's the kids? His voice was low. They're in the living room asleep. He nodded. Look at you, you're soaked right through. Kath squelched his t-shirt. God, have you been swimming? Look, why don't you go for a bath and I'll phone the travel agent. See, there's another flight today. Your shirts are still wet, by the way. She was gabbling into the void and waiting for him to explain, giving him all these chances. And he wasn't, and she had to fill the space. Why are you so late? He put one hand on the banister. I need to go to bed. Okay, fine, but will you just tell me what's happened? I just need to sleep. Jamie, I heard something on the news. Honey, you have to talk to me. What happened? Were you in a car crash? Trying to be calm, and her sore tooth was screaming at her. She kept tonguing it, a constant pressure at the ragged fissure, prodding it to further reaches, and her brain kept booming. What about Mallorca? And he kept walking up the stairs. Jamie, please. He stopped, looked down at her. What did it say in the news? I don't know, something about a girl being shot by police. Still he stood, swaying slightly against the banister. His torso was twisted, his legs facing up the stair, his eyes on Kath below. There's maggots in her belly. Tell me it wasn't you. Tell me it's got nothing to do with you. He frowned, puzzled like a child. Talk to me, God! She tried so hard not to shout. Slowly, his knees sagged into the stairs, his hands squeaking down the spindles till he was staring at her like a monkey in a cage. Sorry. Then she was beside him, squatting down low and cradling his body, feeling him tremble, hard, spastic movements that juddered her breasts. Shh, shh, she kissed his hair. Jamie, what happened? Is she dead? Yes, she's dead. She's dead, all right. Can you not just fucking hug me? And he clambered away, limping on all fours up and into their room, leaving Kath sitting on the stairs, nursing a broken tooth. Her husband had... What would happen to them all? And what about Mallorca?
Wow. Yeah.
But could you pass me a glass of water for us? Yeah, I'm sorry.
Well, I think your books sometimes are deeply moving. You choose just one of those sequels. John here put your books into my hands, and I was hooked immediately. And one thing which is very special about your novels is that you really care about your characters. They are utterly believable, and still there are no heroes, no ordinary heroes, which you could hear from this sequence. They all have their flaws, and that makes them more realistic and also more lovable. And now you read about Jamie and Kath, and I have been thinking about Anna, who is your protagonist, I'd say, isn't she?
I think with the first book, The Twilight Time, I had two definite protagonists, Kath, who's the wife there, and Anna, who features in all of the books. But I tried to have a sort of ensemble cast. Again, I wanted to try and show the breadth of different people that were in the police force, because I think a lot of the time, particularly with uniforms, you see a uniform, you see a stereotype, you don't think there's a variety of people. So, you know, although Anna is my sort of main thread throughout all four books, I did want there to be big parts for other people who were different, so that, like you say, there's no heroes, because nobody's 100% good or 100% bad, but there was this assumption I felt when I joined the police that, you know, you must vote a certain way, you must believe certain things, you must have certain opinions, and everyone would be the same, and that just isn't true.
Yeah, and you shift between chapters when you meet new people. But to stick with Anna for a while, she's such a messed up person, I think. First, when you meet her, she seems so perfect. She's beautiful and blonde and dresses very well. And then she starts to commit every crime in the book. She beats people up, she lies, she commits perjury, she gets sloshed at the wrong time, several times.
It's just a typical Glasgow girl. I didn't think she was that bad.
No, but she doesn't behave like a heroine would, or like an ordinary protagonist in a crime story would, because either they are larger than life, or they are, well, you know, sort of Swedish middle-aged men with bad stomach. And why did you decide to make Anna this way that she is?
Well, again, for the reality, I think, because Anna is, in the first book, she's a sergeant. In this book I've read from, she's an inspector. And later on, she's a chief inspector. So I wanted a woman, one, because that's what I had been. That was my experience as being a female police officer. I thought she would be more interesting to follow, to see how a woman progresses through an organisation that is, again, seen as misogynist and particularly male. But I didn't find it that way. But, you know, there are difficulties because there's less women, and it's not a family-friendly place to work with shifts and the sort of job that you do. So, and with Anna's personality, again, I wanted her to be human, and I didn't want her to be... you know, the noble detective, because she's not. She's a uniformed police officer who deals with messy things. That's what cops do. They're a bit like social workers. You deal with life when it's raw and messy, and quite often when people don't want you to be there. And I think it's true also that if you can begin with high ideals and noble aspirations, and you lose that idealism because people are mean to you. They you know, they don't think there, you've come to help me. They just... We all do it. You see a police officer and you think, oh no, you know, are they going to stop me because I don't have lights on my bike? Or, you know, are they going to breathalyse me? What are they going to do? If you meet someone at a party even, then, you know, people would say, what do you do for a living? And I would say I was a police officer. You would either get people saying, oh, that's interesting, but quite often you would get them going, all right, and kind of moving away. So Anna has dealt with all of this, and I think you become... You expect people to not like you, so you start to behave sometimes in a disagreeable way to almost protect yourself, if that makes sense. You know, you put up barriers, and I think Anna, she's an unhappy person, so she puts up barriers that she doesn't want to be seen to be weak. So in order to be strong, she's maybe a bit bullying and a bit impetuous and doesn't think things through.
Yes, but you take the work and the room in the book to make her into this kind of person, which, well, most people who write these kind of stories wouldn't do that. You seem to be very interested in the persons you write about, and you say you want her to be realistic, but she has so many facets. You could have made her believable, but not with all these different aspects. And I like that. And it's, of course, it's the same with Jamie and Kath and some of the others, but I think even more so with Anna.
Yeah, and I you know, I set out to write books about characters who happen to be police officers, and I very much wanted their job to be secondary to who they were as people. And I think that's where most times the police are portrayed differently, that they're there to carry a story about an investigation through. And that was never my interest when I started writing, because I wanted just to show what simple things, like, you know, you have to deal with a cot death, a baby that's died in unexpected circumstances, is awful, and you have to deal with it in a sensitive way, but equally you have to think, is this a crime? You have to be looking for possible evidence to seize while being respectful to the parents, but not too nice. And then you might have to go home and deal with your own baby and just want to wake them up and hug them because they're alive and that baby was dead, you know. And that sort of thing isn't an investigation, but that's what most cops deal with most of the time. It's the messy things like that, and it's being in someone's life and almost invading their space at a time that they really want to be private, but you have to be there and do your job. And I think that, I don't know, to me that's all about how your character responds. It's not about plot and procedure at all. It's about who you are as a person. And I think I was interested in looking at, you know, the police are seen as protectors. Who protects them? And I don't mean in a lawful sense. I mean, and certainly when I was in the police, there was a culture, you didn't go for counselling. I had a lot of friends that worked at the Lockerbie bombing, you know, the Pan Am jet that crashed over Lockerbie, and it was just at Christmas time, and it was awfully traumatic. People were basically not coming home for a week at a time, and they were in a mortuary dealing with literally piecing together pieces of human beings to try and give them back to their loved ones. They got no counselling for that, and I know many people whose marriages broke up afterwards. So there was that culture of sort of, you just deal with it because that's what you do, and you know, that's what's expected of you.
You're a hard, manly Scotsman, even if you're a Scotswoman.
Yes, or just,
it's,
you know,
very macho somehow.
Yeah, and but also I think, you know, you chose to do this job, therefore that comes with the territory. You know, don't be soft, don't be namby-pamby, and it becomes silly that I was very conscious as a woman, and I think I do this with Anna, my protagonist, that she doesn't want to be seen to be weak, so she overcompensates by being too quick to jump into a fight maybe or something. There was an incident when I was quite new in the job, and there was a big football match on in Glasgow, Scotland and England. Apparently it's a bit like Sweden and Denmark, which I only recently found out there's the same kind of football rivalry apparently. And there was lots of fans in the city centre fighting and rioting and running all over the place, and I was at one point in the city with one other policeman who was much smaller than me, funnily enough. And about 300 mad fans came running towards us in quite a small contained street, and people were sort of jumping into shop doorways to get away from them, and they weren't doing anything really, they were just shouting and swearing, but you know, it was scary for the shoppers. And I thought, I don't want this cop that's with me to go back to the office and see that I was scared. So I marched out in front of this horde and sort of went, "Stop!" At which point my neighbour dragged me into a doorway and said, "What the hell do you think you were doing? How do you think you, one person, could have stopped this horde?" And of course I couldn't, and it was stupid and dangerous, but there was this fear of being seen to be weak that I would do something like that. So I think a lot of that is in Anna, definitely.
Yeah. Now, as we have been talking about being a real man while you're a woman, will you drop dead if I ask you about gender issues?
No, not at all.
Yeah, because we have Anna, but we also have Kath, who used to be a police officer, but is stuck at home with toddlers, or first one baby and then two, and who gets very frustrated. And sometimes she also slips into the investigations, even if she's not really a policewoman any longer. But
was that born from experience as well? Yeah, I'm
with what?
Well,
children.
I left the police when I had my first daughter. My husband was a police officer as well, so there was no job sharing or part time. There was, you know, you could continue working, but it wasn't, again, there was this sense of, you got yourself pregnant, didn't you? You know, you knew the rules before you started this game. And what do you do when you both work shifts? Do you work alternate shifts and never have time together? Do you work the same shifts and then have to have a nanny for 7 nights night shift? You know, it's difficult, and it's not the sort of job that you can always finish on time when you think you're going to finish, because, you know, a rape victim could walk in at 10 minutes before you're due to finish. You can't say, "I'll put you in the drawer and deal with you tomorrow." Of course not. You could be there another 5 hours. So it was a difficult job to balance with a motherhood, and I didn't. I left the police. So Kath's in that position. I write Kath, who you read, I read a bit about there. She was a police officer and is now a stay-at-home mum, and she struggles. She struggles, one, with, nobody told me motherhood was going to be like this, because maybe that was just me, but I felt that a bit, you know. Everything about having a baby is you go to hospital and you give birth and you're happy ever after, and there's not an awful lot about it. And see, for the next 16 years it's going to be quite tricky.
At least 16.
So Kath is struggling with that, and also this sense of that she used to do quite an important job that would get a reaction from people, whether positive or negative, and now she doesn't do anything. She thinks she's at home and she's just somebody's mum, and she doesn't have a status anymore. And she struggles with that.
It's like these people, you talk about them like so-and-so's dad, and you have no idea what they're called.
Yeah, that's true, you know, and you go from, you know, and the police is a powerful job, and you know, if you have an ego, it's the sort of job, it's like, people will listen to you, whether they like it or not, they will do what you tell them, because you can take their liberty away if you don't, and then you go from that to a baby won't even listen to you, and you're talking about, you know, nappy rash, and you think, I used to have a life. Yeah. So, and because Kat's at home, and Anna, who she's not very friendly with, but knows, Anna is Jamie's boss at work. So Kath, as well as feeling the loss of her job, sees this ambitious, pretty woman progressing where Kath can't go anymore, and it's like her husband's progressing with her, and she feels not part of that gang. And I did feel that too, because my husband stayed in the police, and you know, I think a lot of emergency services, you tend to socialise together because of the hours that you keep, and also because of the sort of job that you do, you might develop a really black sense of humour, and other people don't get that, so you sort of gravitate together. And I wasn't in that gang anymore, and that felt difficult, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and of course the problem for Kath is also that Anna and Jamie have had an affair earlier.
Yes, in the first book.
They had it before
and
the first
book.
They have
history, yeah.
Yeah, well, we used to have one lecture in the morning and one in the afternoon, and then we took the children to the department, and then we switched. The one who had the children went into lecture, but that was much easier.
Mm, yeah.
Yeah. Your books are very obviously set in Glasgow, and we talked a bit about this earlier, but it's sometimes a book is set in a place and it doesn't really matter, but it's a very obvious place. And this also is mirrored in the language. People speak dialect, and you write in the Scottish dialect, sometimes, not all the dialogue, but sometimes. And you also spell the words differently. Mm. I can't speak Scottish dialect at all, but it's not only tay and such thing. It's also that you spell whore, H-O-O-R, and you spell police, P-O-L-I-S.
That's to do with the phonetics, like you would say polis.
You say polis.
Poor, rather than whore.
Yeah, I thought it was sort of...
Yeah.
But have you thought about this? Was this an idea that you should make the Glasgow setting so overwhelming that it was not just that they in this street or in this alley, they were going this way, but you also... May the whole universe out of the Glaswegian accent.
I think it was, again, I was trying, you know, when it's your first book, also you have no guidelines or parameters, but I wanted to try and make it as authentic as I could. And I was doing a degree in creative writing at the time at Glasgow University, and one of the lecturers there was James Kelman, who's a very fine Scottish writer. I think he's been nominated for the Booker before. And I talked to him about being uncomfortable with having some swearing in my dialogue, because I don't swear an awful lot as an individual, but the sort of world that the first book is set a lot in the red light district of Glasgow, and you know, a lot of prostitutes and not very nice people, and there's a lot of anger there, and a lot of the time that anger comes out in the language that people use. They don't have, you know, the girls that work there, they can't beat up the people that abuse them, but they can swear a lot. So it felt right for that, and the dialect again. But I felt uncomfortable because I wouldn't speak like that. And he said, well, you have to be true to your story. You don't have any business telling that story if you're not prepared to immerse yourself in it. So I guess the dialect and the Scottish words arose not because I wanted to shoehorn them in to give it a flavour. It's because it felt the most appropriate, you know, word to use. And sometimes my editor's based in London, so... We have discussions discussions. She basically says, take these words out. And I say, no. But when I try and explain what a word might mean, and I'm maybe using five or six words to illustrate it, then that's when I say, you see, that's what I mean. Like a Scottish word, grich, which means damp and wet and cold and dismal. And it's not pouring with rain, but it's kind of drizzly. By the time you said all that, I think the word grich, even the way it looks, and it sort of snarls at you, and it sounds a bit sad. You know, and we learn to read by getting the context from, you know, the words round about sort of will explain what a word means. So I felt if I could use these words judiciously, And with the phonetic stuff, it might help people to get the Scottish, you know, the Glaswegian accent in their heads. And sometimes just even if you, the word nobody would understand, to put another word in would be wrong. One example was I described a character going into a close. Now, a close, what my editor said, what's a close? And a close is the entrance to a tenement flat, which is a sort of sandstone, three or four story front of after the fire's got some tenements on it, three or four story flats. But a close is quite a small tiled hallway. And I think the word close, it makes you feel it's wee and it's constricted. So I said to her, it's the entrance to a close. Sorry, a close is the entrance to a tenement. And then she said, what's a tenement? So I explained it was a flat. And then she said, okay, so we'll call it a foyer. Now, to me, a foyer is modern and it's big and airy and it's totally opposite from what a close is. So although she felt that was a word more readily understandable to people, to me, it actually would give people the wrong impression. And I think close, you would know that close means small and narrow, even if you couldn't picture what a close was. So
a foyer seems like something completely different. Well, I've been writing a lot of historical fiction, and I have realized that you could use words people don't understand because they will understand them for what's around them.
Yeah, totally. I think so.
And as I'm not a native English speaker, I have no problems with your Scottish words.
Yeah.
Of course, sometimes it helps to be Swedish, like when they're greeting instead of crying.
Is that got parallels in
yeah,
Swedish?
It's called gråta.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. Is our time up? I think we've been...
Are we being wound up? Or have we gone a bit longer? You want some questions?
Yeah. Yeah, one more question.
Okay. Well, you started as a police officer and now you write crime fiction. Do you read crime fiction?
I don't. I have only written four books about the police and I don't plan to write any more. I'm about the police. So, no, I don't know many people that have been in the police that read crime fiction, because it's like a busman's holiday, if you know that expression. It's, you know, why in your leisure time would you read about something that you've experienced in your work time? And also, if anyone here is a nurse and you watch a programme about, you know, a sort of soap opera drama about hospitals, I bet you think, you'd never do that in real life. There's no, you know, that's not the right name of that medicine. Cops do that with crime stuff as well.
Oh, but
there's no such thing as this. That's the wrong legislation. So it inhibits your enjoyment of the story.
But I know doctors who love watching House, for example.
Do they?
Yeah.
Just for they get pleasure from it, or do they?
Yes,
sort of nitpick?
Some kind of escape from the real hospital world.
Mm.
So I thought that. Well, of course, you can get inspired to write something because you have lived the reality.
Yeah.
But it's also a difference between fiction and what's happening here.
Yeah.
I just like
to read sort of straight contemporary fiction that has nothing to do with the police. Yeah.
Do you have any favourites that you want to mention?
Well, James Kelman, definitely. If no one's read him, I would heartily recommend him. There's a lot of good contemporary Scottish writing at the moment. A.L. Kennedy and Ali Smith, they both have books.
Oh, I'm happy you mentioned Ali Smith because she's my favourite.
Yeah, I love her. She's a very playful, inventive writer. And I've read a couple of David Mitchell books recently that I really enjoyed. Cloud Atlas and Thousand Autumns of Jacob de Zoet, which I saw on one of the shelves down there. He's an English writer. And I think he was nominated for the Booker Prize actually too, and he came to a reading I was doing in Edinburgh, not because he knew me, he knew the person I was on with, and you know, he'd just been nominated for the Booker at that point, and he asked a question, something about the writing process, and he's a very nice, sweet man, and he said, "Went, I write a bit too."
Oh.
You've just been nominated for the Booker Prize, man. You do a bit, don't you? So he's very nice.
That's lovely. Okay, thank you very much.
Does anyone have any questions for Karen before we move on to the second act? Does anyone have any questions about the books or about Anna Cameron or about Scotland?
No pressure.
I have a question.
Okay.
Could you tell us a bit about your next novel?
Okay, Jan's asking if I could tell a bit about my next novel. So not the one that's just out, but the new one, yeah?
The one that you
just written. Okay,
yeah.
I've just finished a book, and as I say, I was only ever going to write four, I felt, about the police, because with each of those books, I've had a sort of two-year gap between them, so I've tried to follow the characters through their lives, and also through how policing has been changing over a sort of 10-year period, so I did feel I'd got to the end of that. But I still was very interested in Glasgow as a city and the sort of social issues there, and the sort of different layers of lives that go on. You know, it was the same city I went to school in as I was a student in, and then I worked in the police, but it was a different city at each stage in my life, so I think there's a lot of mileage in that. And I decided I would write a story about an asylum seeker coming to Glasgow, because it's a way of seeing the city through someone else's eyes, and someone who is trying to integrate. And the story arose really because my husband was doing voluntary work with the Scottish Refugee Council, and he was mentoring a man from Somalia who now lives in Glasgow. And my husband asked him, why did you come to Glasgow? And the guy said, I didn't. I was sent here. I didn't know that Scotland existed. I'd heard of London, hadn't heard of anything beyond that. So he was parachuted into this totally alien world, and him and his wife and his child basically had to survive and you know, try and integrate into a city that's... Well, for example, he thought he could speak a little bit of English, then he came to Glasgow and he thought, I don't know anything, he's the worst thing. So I just thought that, and he had to actually draw pictures of fish when he went into a shop to sort of show what he wanted to eat. And I just took that idea and I thought, I could write a book about, because I've never been a refugee, and I think every writer wants to move on a bit and not keep writing the same thing. So you want to challenge yourself. I've never been a refugee, I don't think I ever will, but I have been abroad, I'm here just now. And you know what it's like when you're somewhere where you're not comfortable with the language and you think all these things in your head and you can't articulate them. So I've had that feeling, and I thought, I think I could translate that to another person and then have to imagine the rest of what he's left behind and how much more traumatic it's been than me being in Sweden for a few days, but take that feeling and build on it. So yeah, so Bloomsbury have bought that, and it will be out in 2013.
And what's the title?
It's called This Is Where I Am.
Okay, very good. Anyone else? Yes?
You have talked about all the negative things being a police officer and all the crimes you meet. Are there any positive things being a police officer?
Okay, the question was, I've talked about all the negative things about being a police officer. This is the Scot in me, you see. When you ask us, are you okay today? I am no bad. That means you're good.
Sweet are the same.
Are they okay? Well, you know where I'm coming from. So are there any positive things? Absolutely. It's a privilege to do that job. It's literally, you're stopping bad people from doing bad things. And there is nothing more satisfying than whether it's just, you know, kids that have been upsetting an old lady and you make them move on from playing at football or whatever, or, you know, actually arresting somebody who's harmed somebody, to actually feel that you have been that dam, that barrier that stopped them from going any further. That's very satisfying, and also it's a very responsible job, and it's one I was very proud to do. I mean, I don't think I was very good at it, but it's not, you know, I wasn't. I once attended a house alarm it was a burglar alarm on a shop that was ringing, and it was a plate glass window, it was a furniture shop, and I waited for the owner to come. It was night time and we were supposed to go in and check the property together, make sure it was all secure inside and you know, lock it up and get it boarded. And it was raining and I was hungry, and the guy was, oh, it's fine, I'll just get someone to board the front, we'll worry about it tomorrow. So I should have insisted and I didn't. And then the next night when I came on duty, my sergeant said to me, do you know the early shift got a call from that store? When the girl went in to open up in the morning, there was a tramp sleeping in one of the beds. So they had gone in the window. I mean, they'd got in the shop before I had arrived, but I didn't notice as I was standing outside this window that there was a man settling down for the night in the shop. So that was the kind of police officer I was. But you meet a lot of very nice people, and you see a lot of acts of kindness that go unnoticed, and a lot of bravery, and you see the very worst of people, but you also see the very best. So it's a job, I've got two daughters, if either of them wanted to do it, I'd be very proud. And my dad was a police officer, so I knew sort of what I was getting into as well. But it's a difficult job to have a good social life as well, you know, it takes over everything, so that's a drawback.
All right, if everyone's satisfied, perhaps we should move on a big round of applause. Now, our next guest tonight is Helen Fitzgerald. She's from Glasgow, but she's not really from Glasgow. She's Australian, from Melbourne, and I think usually when you introduce Helen, you also mention that she's the next to youngest of 13 siblings. So she has a lot of brothers and sisters, which is an amazing feat, you know, just to live through that. Her books, I've never read anything similar to Helen's books, because they make you laugh, but they are pitch black, and they make you, your jaw drop, just all the way to the floor. And her characters, although searching for love and stability and all the things that that we all want, make a complete and utter mess of it every single time. They make the wrong choices over and over again, and these choices they make are so wrong, you've never seen anything like it. And so they're all very interesting, and they will absolutely make you laugh, but also cringe a bit occasionally. And she's one of my absolute favorite authors, and here she is, Helen Fitzgerald. And I forgot to tell you, we're very importantly, she's written 6 books, I think, at least published by now. Two of them are sort of, this was the first one published, Dead Lovely, and My Lost Confession is the sequel to that. These should be read first, this and then the other one. The Donor is her latest one, just published this summer, which is a great book. And then there's a young adult novel, Amelia O'Donoghue, is so not a virgin, which is very funny and very not funny, as all of them are. And then there's also Hot Flush, which is an easy read. It's published by Barrington Stoke, a great publisher, and it's for adults who don't normally read a lot, and so it's a briefer, simpler story. But it's probably one of my favorites, actually, because the story is so good, and the main character, the woman. Well, you'll have to read it. So, lots of books, and I'll let Helen start, and then Helena Dahlgren, the premier book blogger of the country, actually, will be doing an interview after. Go ahead.
Thank
you. What you're going to read.
Thank you very much. I'd just like to say thanks. Everything that Karen said at the start so well, I'd like to say. Ditto. It's brilliant to be here as an Australian. I've lived in Scotland for 20 years now, but I still find it so exciting that I can get on a plane and be somewhere so different in 2 hours. If you do that in Australia, you're on a plane for 2 hours and you get off, you're really in the same town still. So it's great to be here. Thank you. I was going to read from this book. Yeah, this is my 5th adult book, and it's called The Donor. And you probably notice it's kind of marketed quite differently because, as Jan said, it's been quite hard to categorise me, and my publishers are still trying to work out what the hell my books are. And this one is, you know, dilemma fiction, but it's not. It's the same as the others. It's dark and light. It's about a single father. His wife leaves him when he's got 2 young kids and he's on his own with twins. And when they're 16, they're diagnosed with kidney disease. And I had the idea of the story because my sister-in-law was in this situation where she was diagnosed with a kidney disease that was genetic. It was because of the match of her parents. And 3 of her siblings, there were 5 kids in the family, were also diagnosed with it, very young. So the parents, I think there were 3 healthy kidneys in the family and 3 not. And they were kind of in a situation of, who do we offer our kidney to? And I thought, oh God, and I always start this way with books, or when it makes me think, oh God, I'm glad that's not me, that makes me think, oh, I want to write about that. So this guy is kind of, it's kind of Sophie's Choice with kidneys. That's how my agent said, oh, this is Sophie's Choice with kidneys. He's in a situation where he's trying to save both of his daughters, and there's lots of different options, and they're all pretty bloody awful. And also the other thing that interested me was because I have 2 kids of my own, 14-year-old girl and 11-year-old boy, and just how different your relationship with your children are, you know, and you love them just as much, but, you know, me and my daughter are at each other all the time, and me and my son's very cozy and comfortable and easy, and it doesn't mean that I would save one ahead of the other at all, but it's just that the relationships are different. So
this father Will gets on very differently with his daughters. He's fighting with one of them all the time, with Georgie, and he's very, very comfortable and close with the other one. I was talking to my kids about this, and they were saying, oh God, what a terrible dilemma and terrible situation that would be in. But I was thinking it wouldn't be so bad in some situations, you know, when my daughter's walking out of the house with a really short skirt on and I'm saying, pull your skirt down, and she's sort of saying, or what? Well, I could say, well, your brother gets the kidney. this book came out at the same time as there was a huge debate. It's been all over the news in Scotland, I don't know if here, you know, about whether or not you should be allowed to sell your kidney. And there was an academic up in Dundee who was saying that maybe students should sell their kidneys for £28,000 in order to pay their university fees. You know, this would be a solution. So it was all over. It's a very interesting ethical debate. You know, should it be illegal? Should you be allowed to do it? I know what my father would say. He would say, that's an absolute disgrace. Of course you shouldn't, and especially not for some wishy-washy English literature degree. Maybe if I was doing accounting or something sensible. Anyway, I was going to just read a passage at the start, kind of first off, a very short one, from Will's point of view when he's just discovered the situation that he's in. And then his daughter Georgie, who he has a difficult relationship with when she's just started dialysis. And then I'll move to a section at the back where he's considering one of the options available to him, which is killing himself, suicide. So here goes. And this is where Will's story began. Not sooner than this, because it's not a tale about a frustrated artist or a scorned lover or a new man or a struggling single father. It's a story about kidneys. Two bits of squidgy brown flesh, till now the companion of steak in his mind, but from this moment on linked with survival or not of his daughter. Georgie's kidneys had packed it in, the doctor said, when the test results came back. She had kidney disease. Her liver was suffering. It was rare in teenagers. It was established, chronic, incurable, progressing rapidly. Georgie needed more than medication. She needed machines to sustain her for now and a transplant to sustain her for longer. But the chances were slim, her type rare. It was a genetic disease caused by the gross mismatch of Will and Cynthia. How many more ways could they have been mismatched? Which meant Kay was screened in Glasgow almost immediately after her sister's diagnosis. Was Will more scared waiting to hear about Kay's result? Did he sleep less, eat less, tremble more? Was he angrier when it came in, or was it a natural reaction to the doubling of misfortune? Did he cry more when they told him Kay would have to wait just as long? And when he punched the door of his never-renovated kitchen, was it because both of them had rare types? Or was that jagged fist hole for Kay alone? If bad luck comes in threes, Will felt he'd had all his. Georgie's body was dying, Kay's body was dying, and he was the only probable and willing match. Locked in the upstairs bathroom, shirt off, black marker in hand, he drew a kidney shape on his left side and another on his right. These are my kidneys, he said, and there's only one spare. Almost as soon as I became ill, I got a new boyfriend. He presented me with a comfy armchair and I accepted. He was dull and predictable, a replica of my father. He liked to feed me, but he couldn't cook. He liked to be with me, but he had nothing to say. He liked to give, but he always took more. Oh, gurgling machine. I'd have liked a different kind of boyfriend, one who moved, for example. One who touched me and didn't just stick it in me and suck and drip and turn my arm to noisy lumps. But I couldn't have a different kind of boyfriend. I probably never would. What would I say? Not Monday, Wednesday, Friday or Sunday, Jim, for example. I'll be busy then. We could have dinner after, he might suggest, and I'd have to say, but where? What kind? Because there's all sorts of shit I can't eat now, like bananas. If I eat a banana, I'll probably die. But then I'll probably die anyways. What about a walk? I'd love to, Jim, but I'm exhausted, like, all the time. What about we watch a movie on one of the days in between? Nope, I'll be too busy drinking gallons of water and feeling like crap, and anyways, I'm yellow. Do you really want a yellow girlfriend? Bye-bye, Jim, for example. I named my new boyfriend Alfred. He looked like an Alfred, a square white robot with wires, some very red, some less so. Sometimes I imagined him talking to me, and it was always with a deep Alfred-like voice. Now, now, Georgina, you know you should stay still. Alfred, who sucked me out and filled me up again and would do so till I died or till someone else died first. A very special someone with a limited Gucci bag kidney like mine. The type you see in the Get Her Style section of magazines, carried by a B-grade celeb who joined the waiting list and paid thousands to get that damned bag in order to improve her standing. It was more boring than visiting one of Dad's housewives for coffee, or reading a full non-fiction book, or listening to Dad read his pre-proposal for an outline of a short film. He read it to us when we were 10. 15 minutes had never been more excruciating. What was it about again? All I can remember is a leaf. It was not a very interesting brown. I couldn't even smoke in there, had to use foul nicotine chewing gum that made me hiccup. The doctor in Edinburgh gave me a leaflet when he had told me I needed Alfred. On the front of the leaflet, a woman was sitting in a chair like mine, smiling happily as if it was the best place in the world to be. You should try this, her smile said from the glossy page. You should try it now, even if it's very expensive. The woman was at least 40. Perhaps for her it was fun, compared with fighting face lines and ordering toilet paper in bulk. But I was 16, I had parties to go to, drugs to take, countries to see, love to fall in. I bet the woman on the brochure didn't even have the disease. I bet when they wrapped the photo shoot, she said, "Thanks, Maxie," whisked the plug from her unpunctured arm and went out shopping while eating a banana. Wish they'd have asked me to pose for it. I'd have done the Vicky and then the middle finger and then the loser sign and then scowled. They are all liars. This is fucking dreadful. I hate it and so will you. Some say boredom enhances creativity. Sickly children go on to direct Oscar-winning films and pen Booker-winning books. I didn't give a fuck about writing books or directing films. I wanted to go down the Offie and enter Club Boho. I wanted to shag someone again. Would Alfred really be the love of my life? That's it, right there, Alfred, yes. There is something very unsexy about depending on someone. If I pulled him out, I'd regret it, so I wouldn't. I'd semi-decline there 4 times a week, 4 hours ago, and be thankful for Alfred while hating the very sight of him. For most people, I suppose, this is what marriage is like. I had a coping strategy. I wasn't going to think about any of it anymore. I wasn't going to worry about my blood and how dirty it was and where it came from and who it came from anymore. After Dad left, I decided to go out and find a real boy. His name would not be Alfred. What colour would you say I am? I asked a boy who went by the name of Eddie. As usual, I felt tired and nauseous, but I was on a mission. I don't know, normal? You're a smooth talker, Eddie. Pink then, like very nice roses. That was better. Eddie had a job and a flat. I wasn't interested in either. My attempt to fall in love with him went something like this. Before I list the events, let me just tell you outright that it failed. Eddie and I drink too much beer in a pub in the south side, then get a taxi into a club in the town where we drink too much vodka. Eddie dances badly, but he likes the way I dance. He holds me by the hips, hooks one leg through mine, and tries to rub me with the top of his quad. Eddie says we should get out of here. In the taxi, Eddie puts his hand under my shirt and feels my nipple. I'm so tired. I don't like having my nipples felt tweak, tweak, pinch. Why? We arrive at his flat in Shoreland, and still determined to fall in love, I follow him up a paint peely close and into the hall, which has 3 bikes in it. What do you like about me? I ask him, and he says it's my tits. In the bedroom, Eddie undresses. He's very thin and white. I can see at least 2 ribs. He has either shaved his pubic hair or he's 11. His penis looks like a nose. What first attracted you to me? I ask him. It was your tits, he says, pulling my bra over my head without bothering to unclip it and catching my top lip for a moment along the way. He pops one of what he likes about me in his mouth. I feel sick. I don't like how he's gnawing at me. What am I, a breastfeeding mother? Unlatch, I say. So he does, a little taken aback, before heading towards the lower region, taking my jeans and pants down, kneeling. Am I actually going to vomit? I don't like how he's lapping at me. When you spotted me on the dance floor, did you think I was beautiful? I ask, but his mouth is too busy to say more than, Eddie is very quick at what he does next. Jack, rabbit, bang, 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 and he's so thin I can hardly feel him on top. And he sighs and slides off and says, and lights a fag, and I say, well? And he says, well, what? And I say, what was it that attracted you to me? And he says, God, haven't we done enough talking already? And I need the bathroom now, but it's already coming out as I say, I'm never going to fall in love with you, Eddie. Now, moving on to the very end where Dad, Will, is getting quite desperate. He's quite drunk as well. He's just had a big fight with Georgie. The house was empty. Will was glad because he had things he needed to do privately. He went into his office before his morning coffee, picked up his notebook, had he left it open, and sat on the sofa bed. He inhaled deeply and blew the air onto the notebook. Four, he wrote at the top of page four. He couldn't write the word, how could he? Then if he couldn't write it on a piece of paper, how would he ever do it? Suicide. Will felt like he'd already done it, like scratching I Love Cynthia on the fence of the bothy after their third date all those years ago. If he hadn't loved her before that scribe, he felt he must after. About 55,600,000 Google results. Suicide was a popular subject. He narrowed the criteria. How to commit suicide safely, and deleted safely, as it was ridiculous, and clicked on Wikipedia's succinct guide to the choices available. Options now forming a list in his notebook, Will pondered, scoring them out of 10 thus. Pesticides, would screw up organs, 0 out of 10. Bleeding, wrist cutting, oh God, I'm too scared, and apparently this can be much worse than you expect, 2 out of 10. Drowning, how would they get me out of the lock, river or swimming pool? Timing would be very difficult, I'd need a fit attendant, 1 out of 10. Suffocation, hard to manage head bag on my own, I'd naturally fight against it, 2 out of 10. Electrocution, oh, can get seriously burnt too, still pretty quick, 4 out of 10. Jumping, I'm afraid of heights and kidney may be pulp, 0 out of 10. Firearms, 8 out of 10. Hanging, oh, but do I have to? If you get it wrong, it can go on for ages. If you get it right, 7 out of 10. Seppuku, samurai warrior style. Could I be a warrior? Maybe. Could I dress up all fancy? Research dress requirements and purchase online. Could I hold my sword before me? By sword. Could I place my special cloth beneath? Need special cloth as well. Could I read my death poem? Often sidetracked. Will set on two on the death poem required for a samurai warrior to commit seppuku. 1 hour and 17 scrunched sheets of A4 paper later, this was the result, death poem. I've always found it difficult to choose the perfect gift till now. Smile about this, please, when you open this smile. Though wrapped with love, the paper is meaningless, as I've only ever lived through you, and this way I can continue. He was pleased with his poem, it made him cry. He wiped his tears and wrote, could I open my kimono, take up my sword and plunge it into my abdomen? Could I make a cut to the left, a cut to the right, an upward stroke? I would need an attendant. Find an attendant who does not think this all too weird. The attendant standing by on the second stroke would perform Daki Kubi when I was all but decapitated, leaving a slight band of flesh attaching my head to my body. Fuck it, that sounds dreadful. 0 out of 10. Assisted suicide. Okay, here we go. Legal, painless, just need compelling reason to die. What would be more compelling than my reason? Dignified, not scary, kind, clean, calm. As he Googled, he became more and more excited. Dignitas. People went there all the time. Never came back, mind. Dignitas, the Swiss suicide clinic, the 5-star suicide clinic, the suicide clinic voted by users as the best suicide clinic in the world. Could it be painless? Could he arrange safe immediate transplants in Switzerland? He'd considered being a kidney tourist. Why not a Sydney suicide tourist? He'd always wanted to travel. He read everything there was to read about it online. It was a crushing blow when he discovered that he needed recommendations from doctors, which he would never get, and that the girls may be prosecuted for helping him. 2 out of 10, he wrote, downhearted. So, he thought, perusing the very tidy list, which had, in fact, taken up 3 pages after the one he'd ripped out earlier. It'd have to be the gum. Thanks.
God, I love Georgie, I just have to say that. Did you sometimes, while writing the book, sort of secretly root for Georgie as well?
Oh yeah, I love Georgie, yeah, and I really like writing characters. In fact, I get quite offended and defensive sometimes when people say, God, she's horrible, because I don't think she is. I think she's just a feisty and very sick 16-year-old girl who's really struggling to cope with a lot of difficult situations.
Mm, absolutely, yeah. I'm so pleased to be sitting here with you, by the way. Ever since I read Dead Lovely a couple of years ago, I've just been so in awe that people actually write books like yours, because I've been looking for it for ages. You know, it's pitch black and it's so funny and it's sick as hell. And we were talking earlier on with Karen and Karina about some Anna supposedly behaving badly, and I was just sort of stifling a laugh because, you know, in comparison to your characters,
she's an angel.
Yeah, she's the blood of Mother Teresa.
Yeah, I really, really like writing. I like Jan said about just really bad decisions, because I've made a few of those too, I suppose.
Who hasn't?
And I really understand it. And I think a lot of it also comes from the fact that I was a criminal justice social worker, a probation and parole officer, and I worked with offenders. And that's how Karen and I kind of got to know each other, is actually because we'd both written books at the same time our first one came out. We both came from a kind of criminal justice background, and we naturally were writing about that world, but didn't intend really to be crime writers. But I think the difficult and awful situations that I encountered every day at the prison and outside of the prison really informed a lot of the characters that I write. But also I think that the terrible female characters that I write about are just me. Hands up.
Yeah, but see, I don't think they're that terrible. I mean, they are seriously fucked up when they have major issues. But, I mean, and then again, who hasn't?
Yeah.
And, I mean, obviously, moral has been completely thrown outside the window, and, you know, it's very twisted and black. But, I mean, I can relate to most of them, actually. I mean, especially, I think, Bronwyn from The Devil's Staircase.
Yeah, I love Bronwyn from
She's
sort of
a heroine, isn't she?
Yeah.
She's so cool.
She's probably a little bit more bland than the other female coach. She's an 18-year-old who runs off from Australia to avoid knowing whether she has a disease, basically, and kind of runs away and lives with other Australians in a squat in London. And I didn't have the disease thing, but I did, you know, kind of go to London, live in a squat with a whole bunch of other Aussies, very decadent, fantastically fun life. The only difference being there wasn't a woman bound and gagged in the basement, unless she's still there. I didn't realise. But yeah, she's a great character, and I'm really very fond of her. But she's probably less dark and less twisted than the other female characters that I write.
Katriona from Bloody Women is another favourite of mine.
She marries an Italian. That's
autobiographical.
Yeah, there's always something. In that one, this woman goes on a tour of her ex-boyfriends before deciding whether or not she's doing the right thing by getting married to a guy and she's going to move to Italy. Well, apparently my husband says I did this, that I went over to Australia before the wedding, and then I kind of grabbed him by the hand and took him around Australia meeting my ex-boyfriends and kind of going, yeah, rightio, yeah, you are better. But in this book, Katrina, three of the four ex-boyfriends wind up dead.
And Bloody Women also has a brilliant first chapter. I mean, I started reading it on the bus and I was basically wetting myself laughing. I mean, it's so twisted and weird. Can you tell us a little bit about
setup? It starts off with Katrina in a morgue being asked to identify a penis, basically. And she says, yes, that is him. Are you sure? Yes. She says, it had an unusually large slit at the top. I read that once at a reading in a very posh suburb in Glasgow, and basically everybody left. No one bought my book after that. Oh, filthy woman.
Your books do tend to be a bit on the graphic side. Have you had a lot of reactions along the line of, but you're such a nice girl, but why do you...
My mum said that. She's a literature teacher, and she's really, you know, a great writer herself and a real lover of literature. And I was so nervous about sending her my first effort, which was Dead Lovely, and that's, you know, got quite a lot of stuff in it, which really, it's got the word semen on the first page, for example. So I sent it to my mum.
Not sailors.
And she said, look, I think you could do without the rude bits, Nelly. You know, you don't need them. Your writing is very good, but she wasn't particularly shocked, and she got it. But it's interesting because as I go along, my editors have been trying to tone me down a bit too, I think. But I really like her, and I'm not doing it just so that people go, well, I talk that way. I am quite filthy, and I quite like writing that way, so.
Yeah, I have to confess, I was a bit scared when I read the premises for The Donor. You know, two daughters, one heartbreaking choice. You can always just hear the American voiceover. It did seem a bit like I don't know, Joan of Kerr, and sort of along the lines of dilemma fiction, but I was so happy to find out that it's a regular Helen Fitzgerald novel.
Yeah, I think it's interesting.
With kidneys.
Yeah, with kidneys. They've just had so much trouble kind of getting me right. This has sold more, though, because I think people think it is Joan of Kerr.
Yeah, it does look
But we had, you know, we had a lot of umming and ahhing, but the other ones weren't quite working, it wasn't quite crime, and it's just been difficult to get the marketing right for me, I think. Mm. And I think they changed it to One Impossible Choice, because Heartbreaking sounded too much like Misery Lit,
yeah.
And it's not that, you know. But it's getting closer to the right kind of cover, but still not right, I don't think.
Yeah, we're talking about that a bit. It's quite difficult to categorise your writing. I mean, it's not quite crime, although people do tend to die rather horrific deaths. some people have mentioned the C word, as in chick lits. It's sharp and entertaining and funny, but at the same time, I can't really imagine Bridget Jones in the same situation as Katrona in the beginning of Another Women. You know,
it would have made a better film, though.
Yeah, definitely. How would you like to be categorised yourself if you had to pick?
I really don't care. I really don't mind, as long as people, because the book is the book, you know, so if people read it and like it, then they like it and read it. What I don't want to do is put people off, and I think chick lit puts people off, and it's not that. And it's also a bit kind of, it's a bit of a shame, because it's just because there's a woman in it, and sometimes it's funny, and it kind of gets labelled. I don't care. I don't care how I'm categorised. This one isn't on the crime shelves, it's just on the fiction shelf. So I don't know.
I think I've actually mentioned the word chic noir for you on a publication.
Yeah.
I think that's pretty good, because I mean, obviously the women are a major part of your books, and the noir bit is very dark and gritty and...
Someone also said thinking women's noir, which I think was really offensive to that's the 3% of women who think.
and also, I mean, people do read your books being male as well.
Yeah, that's
perhaps
right.
Not bloody women, but...
I found...
castration exciting, but...
I think the penis shot thing did put some men off, actually. Definitely off me. It's an interesting thing, but I mean, the book is the book, and it's just, but it's about getting it on, it's getting in the shops and getting so people can see it, I suppose. But men have liked my books, and one of my big worries is putting them off by the title or the, you know, so it's tricky. I'll get there one day.
I think I will have. But going back to the donut, for me it was particularly heartbreaking, I think, to read, because I actually have twin girls at home, identical twins, just like Georgie and Kay. Mm-hmm. And I mean, just the idea of having to choose between them, you know, which one to see, it's just can't wrap your head around it.
I know, it's horrendous, and you couldn't. People seen Sophie's Choice, you know, that was just such an upsetting movie to watch. And I think that had a big impact on me, and I was thinking about it when I came up with the idea. But it's the most horrendous thing you could ever imagine. And like I said, it is having different stages of life. I definitely write about certain things. Soon I'll be writing, like, Hot Flush is all about menopause, and the next ones after that will just be about death, I suppose. But this is about, you know, loving your children when you bring them up and hoping to God that you're doing everything right, but knowing that you're probably not, you know, because none of us are.
But death actually plays a major part of all your books, I'd say, to a certain degree. And also illness. This isn't your first book dealing with illness and medical conditions. The Devil's Staircase, as we mentioned earlier. Bronwyn is sort of running away from a diagnosis. She doesn't want to know whether she's ill or not. And Catriona deals with depression and manic depression.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have an interest in medical?
I suppose I must, but I think more than that, a lot of these books have been written in the midst of a midlife crisis where you are just thinking about death and mortality a lot, and what's the point of everything. I've never really been fascinated. You know, my job, I suppose, in social work, that was always a part of the people and the criminals that I was meeting all the time. There was always stuff like that going on, terrible stories, terrible health situations, terrible choices. And I'm very interested in that. I haven't got any personal stories except, for example, my sister-in-law I was telling you about with the kidney situation, but my family have all been very healthy. It's been very lucky, so it's not come from anything like that. But the fear of death and fear of illness, definitely.
Yeah.
I suppose.
Speaking of family, Jan mentioned earlier that you actually have 12 siblings, which is quite remarkable. Did that in any way affect your choice to become a writer, which has to be arguably the loneliest job in the world, just be alone?
Yeah, I was always called the quiet one. I was hid from the many, many sort of fights that were always going on with the siblings. And I was also very sick as a child. With asthma, was actually. You just asked me about illness, so probably that is. This is therapy for me.
Yeah.
So I was alone a lot in hospital, and I think I just was always thinking up stories, desperately wanting my own space, never getting it, always sharing a bedroom with two or three other siblings, and not having any space or room to think of my own. And I think it influenced that, as well as the fact that my mum, like I said, is an English literature teacher, and she absolutely loved it, and she was always reading to me. And you know, she and I had a real bond with our love of reading and our love of writing. But it also influenced the fact, I think, that I left Australia. And I just left on a trip and just kind of never went back. And I love my family, we're really, really close, but I think I just always needed my space and love being alone. So, yeah, and I think nothing to me is better than sitting on a train for like a 6-hour trip and just staring out a window and thinking up stories. And that's quite weird, really.
It's the same thing being a twin mum, I think, you know, just craving the alone time.
Mm.
Being an Australian, having lived in the UK since, I think, 1991, do you keep up with the Australian literature scene at all?
Well, I had a publisher there initially, but we kind of fell out because she thought my characters were too awful. She didn't like Chrissy, and so
she didn't like Chrissy?
She wanted me to rewrite Chrissy completely, so she became just some kind of quite bland investigator, and I refused to do that, so we kind of parted ways. But I've heard that it's really tough over there at the moment. I think the book-selling industry is, like everywhere, but particularly there, and books are so expensive. So I haven't pursued it. I'm writing a book at the moment which is set in Australia, and I was thinking maybe I should try and get an Australian publisher again, you know, because I am Australian. But I think it would be pretty tough to... And it's a very small market, I suppose, too.
Yeah,
and I haven't had that need to be glorious in my home country, you know.
Profit in home
country.
Yes,
yeah. I think the fact that I've moved away, they hate me anyway, because Australians, why did you leave? It's the best bloody country in the world. Right? Why would you leave here? Live in Scotland, of all places. So it's not something I've given a huge amount of thought.
Well,
yeah.
I was actually astonished when I learned that your debut novel, Dead Lovely, was published in 2007, which means that you've actually written 6 books, well, at least published 6 books, going on 7, I think, now, in the last 4 years.
I know.
What's your secret? Are you on speed or something?
I think maybe the manic depression thing, isn't it? Was I on speed? A little bit of speed. I think what happened was I had been writing for a long time doing screenplays. My husband's a screenwriter. He seemed to write a screenplay quite quickly and it would be made into a short film or a film, and I thought, well, that's easy. He's not that clever. If he can do it, I can do it. So I wrote a lot of screenplays. Dead Lovely was originally a screenplay, and I'd been getting quite a lot of development money from, you know, Scottish Screen and different producers and stuff, and I was in development hell for years, rewriting screenplays. And Dead Lovely, which originally was called The West Highland Way, was one of those. I think the reason why I wasn't getting anywhere with screenwriting was because it wasn't really what I wanted to do. But also they're much more, even more worried about genre. So I was supposed to be writing romantic comedies, really, and that's what they'd bought. And then I would start killing people and saying, it's really great, and now there's a paedophile in it. And they're like, what? So I thought, well, if this one falls down and doesn't get made, it was looking very, very close, then I'll do what I've always wanted to do, which is to write a book. And it didn't, and it did fall through. So I sat down and wrote Dead Lovely in about a day. You know, it just went, whoa.
Wow.
Not a day, but 3 months. But it was non-stop, fantastic, manic writing. And I think it was just I had quite a lot of stories. I had the stories down, and I could just sit down. And it felt like I had been swimming upstream, and I just... turned around, and it was just so much easier for me. It was the right thing for me to be doing.
Yeah,
I wrote very fast and non-stop, completely neglected my children for about 2 years.
Like Chrissy.
not as bad as that. But I was really, really in another world, and it was great fun, but I've slowed down now a bit.
Mm.
Yeah.
A lot of your books have a rather shocking twist. Do you start with a plot, and are you always aware of the twist coming along, or... How do you
I always feel if I tell people this, then you don't sound as clever, but what I do is I write. I know the setting and the dilemma that's the beginning, and I know the characters. So, for example, I'm writing one at the moment, and I've written 50 pages, and it's all set up, and the terrible inciting incident has happened. A baby has died accidentally on a long haul flight to Australia. So I know that, and then I usually think, oh God, I've done 50 pages, I've got everything there, now where am I going? And so what I do is I take a back seat and I think about it for a while and write about a 15-page outline, and then I write the rest of the book. So that's exactly where I'm at with this one at the moment. And I don't know exactly who's, you know, the nasty piece of work yet, or exactly what happens, but I'll work that out.
Yeah, you know what to work with.
Yeah. And so I think that's why it's unexpected for readers, because it's also unexpected for me.
Can you tell us a bit more about what you're working on at the moment? I heard some rumours, actually, it might be on your Twitter, that you're thinking about writing a new Chris novel as well.
Oh, yeah. Well, I started writing one about a stalker, and I only wrote a page, and I thought, I've got to put that away. I'm already writing two books at the same time, and I can't write three. So I'm not doing that now, and no one has asked me to, so I won't. And also, I think with series, you can't have a character making terrible, terrible decisions over and over again. You know, you just want to kill her in the end. So I've just put her to the side, maybe one day. But I'm working on a book called Cry, which is about a couple who accidentally overdose their baby on the long-haul flight to Australia, like I just said, and then decide to cover it up, which is a very bad decision, and it kind of snowballs. As I've just said, I don't know what it snowballs into exactly, but I'll work that out. And I'm also doing a teen book, a young adult book for Soho Press in America called Shots, and it's a kind of much bigger story and a bigger idea, and it's hopefully going to be the first of a series. So I'm about halfway through that.
So, really looking forward to it. Speaking of young adults, you've already published a book with a brilliant, I think, title, Emilio Donoghue's So Not a Virgin. What's the main difference, do you think, writing for young adults?
The only difference is, I think, as Maxim Gorky said, you should write for children the same, only better. And I really don't sort of do anything differently. I probably don't swear as much. But so it's shorter. And I think the reason I do young adult is because someone said, you write very concisely, your books are quite short, your chapters are quite short, so you're already suited to that kind of writing. So I didn't have to change much at all. But it's interesting that you talk about Emilio O'Donoghue, because it was out in America, and I looked it up on Amazon to see how it was doing. And I always worried about the title. I thought the title was fantastic, but it was a bit, you know, having the word virgin there is a bit sort of risky. But I looked down towards, they say, customers who bought this book also bought, and the customers who'd bought Emilio O'Donoghue's So Not a Virgin also bought The Panty-Teasing Niece, Family Man, Uncle's Lust. Paedophiles were buying my book. And it was doing really, really well, so I had this dilemma. Do I just let them, I'll be very disappointed in it, it's not going to turn them on, but do I just let them keep buying it? Obviously on the Kindle they were looking up words like teenage and virgin and coming up with my book. So title's really important, because I was really proud of that title, but I think maybe it was the wrong one.
Yeah. It's not really about Emilio O'Donoghue.
No, that's true. No, I just liked the name. I probably should have changed the name of the,
But I really like the way that you didn't tone down the difficult and dark stuff just because you were writing for young adults.
No,
because I think that's something that a lot of people do, and they do it for the wrong reasons. Like, they're trying to sugarcoat things.
Absolutely. I know my daughter, she likes good quality stories, and we don't tend to edit stuff too much for her. If it's a good, interesting story on television or in a book, then she'll like it. But I think it depends on your editor. I've got a friend who's a young adult writer, and there's no way she would have had that title. I've got the F word, and you know, I say shit and all sorts of stuff in the one I'm writing, and my editor's fine with it, but hers wouldn't let her do that in a million years. It'd be interesting, but he might edit it out at the last minute.
Yeah.
He might just find and replace shit with, you know, something else.
Shoot.
Sugar.
Yeah. Are you a big reader as well?
I don't read all the time. I'm a binge reader, I think, and I find it really hard to read when I'm writing. So at the moment, I'm not reading much at all. And I read all sorts of different things. Like Karen, I wasn't drawn to crime, probably because that's what I was doing for my job. So I didn't feel like doing that when I got home. I've always found it quite difficult to sit still, and I think that's a problem for me. And my daughter's the same. But I do read, but just not 10 books a week.
Yeah. to just read three, so I mean 10 books, that's a bit over. Do you have any writers who inspire you in your own writing? And
I suppose I've always liked what I studied Russian literature, and I like the pace, and you know, and I like things about crazy women, you know. I think you've said that Helen Zahavi was the closest.
Yeah, exactly.
And I loved her. And I like mad women in attics, women on the verges of nervous breakdowns, interestingly. So yeah, I was always drawn to that kind of depressing story. The most recent one was Revolutionary Road that I hadn't read, and I read
love
it. It was
one.
Just brilliant. Yeah.
That's fantastic. Do you have more time for questions, or should we?
You can finish it up with one or two more questions.
Yeah.
And then we do some general
questions. Yeah. Okay. Looking down the line, what do you want to pursue in the future when you're finished with your projects that you're working on at the moment? Do you have like a big plan for, you mentioned the young adult series that might turn into a reoccurring thing.
Yeah, that might be a series, but I suppose an interesting thing that's going on at the moment for me is, because my husband is a screenwriter, he's done the adaptation of The Devil's Staircase, so he's written the screenplay and done several drafts of that. And we've got a producer in Scotland and a producer in Australia working on it together. And they're putting it out to cast, and we've got a sales agent, and the script's really, really tight. So we're hoping that that will come off the ground quite soon. We're hoping that we'll become a booked film adaptation factory in our house. And Serge is now going to write this one as well as a film. So that's our plan, basically, to, I mean, not necessarily all of them, because there's, like, Bloody Women, I don't think would make it.
No, but I think The Devil's Staircase should make a fantastic movie. I mean, it's so bloody scary.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not easily spooked at all, but I read it alone. I was sick the other week, actually, I hadn't read it before, and I was reading it, and I was terrified. It's just so scary.
Yeah, it is scary. We're kind of calling it a thriller, but it'll be horror thriller.
Yeah,
I suppose.
It actually has a bit of a horror.
Yeah. When I started that, I thought it would be a horror book, but it turned into more of a thriller, which is, I suppose, the closest to what I would say my books are. But that and the teen book that I'm writing and the adult, I've got quite a lot, a big queue in my head of things to write, and I probably just need to calm it down a bit, actually, if anything.
Don't.
But the film stuff is great fun, and working out how to actually adapt a book and what you have to get rid of. And I think because I've done the screenwriting stuff before I wrote books, I'm realistic about that, and I know that you're not going to be able to have all of those characters and all of those situations, and you will really have to get to the thread of the story and get rid of a lot of the other stuff, you know, because the screenplay is about 100 pages with a lot of white spaces on the page. And books, you know, this is about 250, so there's a lot you have to get rid of.
Have to kill your darlings.
Yeah, and so Serge and I sit there in the same office, you know, half the time I go to a different office, but then he'll be sitting there saying, so, you know, what would Bronnie be wearing now, and what would she eat for breakfast? And it works really well because I know the characters so well, and the story so well, and he's a great writer of dialogue and everything. So it's a good partnership. Hopefully it won't end in divorce. We'll see.
Yeah. So. Thank you so much. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.
Are there any questions for Helen from the audience? Say. So anyone who wants? Yes, go ahead.
I just wonder if you have any audience in the criminal society. I mean, have you shown
me? Asking whether I've got any criminals who read my books. Interestingly, I went there to Barlinny Prison, which is the men's prison in Glasgow, and that's where I worked for 2.5 years, mainly with sex offenders. But recently, I had a German television crew filming me for, you know, they were pitching my book to the arts program or something. So I went into Barlinny and did a reading for some of the guys. Obviously none of the guys that I worked with were there, because I was so effective that they're all completely rehabilitated and now, you know, working in the community. So I didn't recognise anybody, but that was really interesting to go in, and the best reading I've ever done, because they were hilarious. The first question I got was, how much do you earn? And then at the end, the guy who was filming said, look, I've got a bit more, I'd like to get some reaction shots, could you read a bit more? And it was my last confession, so I just picked a page and opened it, unfortunately, and read a prison rape scene. And I'm halfway through and I'm like, I'm sorry, I can't read this, I have to stop. No, keep going. And I didn't, but afterwards they all immediately went and got the book and said, we found it. It was really brutal, horrible prison rape scene. So, but apart from that, no, I haven't, and I've always wondered about, you know, trying to catch up with some of them to, you know, to see where they're at and just to talk about how they felt about the job that I was doing as well, because it's a bizarre kind of job. But apart from that, and I know they're in the library at Balony Prison now, so hopefully the guys are reading it. Interestingly, they do like reading prison stuff. I thought that the last thing the prisoners would want is stuff about, you know, prison, but that's what they like reading. It's all crime in the prisons. Yeah, I suppose that's not such a surprise, really, is it?
Anyone else? Go ahead.
You said that you wrote poetry for 2 months at one point. I mean, having two writers in the house is probably a bit crazy. But how do you discipline yourself to write, or do you wait for the impulse, or how do you work around that?
Did everyone hear that? It's just about whether I discipline myself to write or whether I wait for the impulse. I discipline myself. I like to write regularly, but sometimes I don't believe in writer's block. I think when I can't get the words out, it's because there's a plot problem. There's something that I need to just take the time, sit back and think about. And I was saying to Jan yesterday that quite often those are sorted out exercising, when I'm on the treadmill or somewhere like that, and it's like, oh, okay, that's it. And then I can sit down and write. I write most days, but sometimes it might be 3 words and sometimes it might be 3,000 or 4,000. The other day I had a marathon of about 7,000 in 2 sittings. But that's not that often. But most of the people I know who are writing a book a year, like Karen and I, you do have to, and it is a job, so we do try to write. And even if it doesn't feel very inspired, you have to do those business sections of writing that are just getting you through a certain part of the plot, and then you can maybe go back and try and rework it so it's a little more interesting and better written.
Stina?
You've written a lot of different kinds of books. Do you have any favourite book, or is that like choosing between your children?
Yeah, it's a bit like choosing between my children. It's always the one that I haven't done yet. You know, at the moment I think the next one, Cry, is just so much better than all of those. But I've felt that every single time, you know, that the next one is the one that's really good. And it's just because I'm not bored with it yet, you know. Dead Lovely, the first one, I have a lot of affection for, because it was such a joy to write and to realise that I could. And I got to the end of the book and cried my eyes out with joy and grief for losing these characters. And I remember telling my social work friend this. I said, it's like grieving. He said, oh God, you're a wanker, a pretentious wanker. But it's true. And I loved writing that book, and I'm very proud of it. But otherwise, no, not really. It's always the next one that I think is going to be the one.
Anyone else? Yes.
Do you have Have you ever regretted something that you've written or a plot, and you said afterwards sort of thought that, oh, I should have done this or changed?
Have I ever regretted and thought I should go back and change something? A little bit in terms of the point of view changes I did in Devil's Staircase and Dead Lovely. I really enjoyed doing that because I liked the jolting here, you know, and I felt that was what gave the book energy, that I did this and then I did that and then it was coming from here. And it was almost a bit like the job I had done, which was doing assessments and risk assessments on offenders, and you would get information from here and there and then piece it all together. And that's how I wanted to write. But I think I maybe did it a little bit too much, and I could have probably, and I don't do as much change as a point of view now. In the next one, maybe there'll be two. And I think in The Donor, there was only 2 points of view. So that's the only thing. In terms of plot, no, I'm always quite happy with the plot. There are little things, like I thought The Devil's Staircase, you wouldn't have a key in the sauna. And I always knew that. And I should have just taken that out and made it something else. And little kind of devices that maybe I got wrong. And I notice as my husband's writing the screenplay, like for The Devil's Staircase, I'm thinking, that's better, what he's done with that. He's kind of made the victim a different person, and it works really, really well. So I'm starting to think maybe I should go back and rewrite that as it's written for the film.
I have a question. 6 books, 4 different publishers. Of course.
What happened was I had a bit of a because I'd written so much, I'd written the two The two first ones, Dead Lovely and My Last Confession, Faber bought those, and Polygon had missed out on them. And they said, has she got anything else? And I'd already written, I think, The Devil's Staircase, or 50 pages of it. And they said, well, could we look at that now? And we said to Faber, look, do you want to buy these? And they said, well, we've already bought two. She's an untested author. We can't buy any more than that. But we're okay with her having, you know, with Polygon having a look. So basically I had two publishers at the same time. So Polygon bought those two books, Faber bought those two books, and it was all a bit much, actually, because three came out in 1 year in the UK, and it was a bit wasted in terms of trying to get the right PR and stuff for it. But, yeah, that was why.
And then the young adult is published in America and not in the
UK.
Yeah,
so that was an American deal, and, so it was a bit... I think you can get very excited at the start, this is the next big thing, and I guess I was hot at that point of being bought all over the place, so that's why. Then for the fifth one, the donor, Polygon and Faber offered together, and I went with Faber and decided.
How did you make that decision?
It wasn't money, although if there'd been a big difference it would have been, but I just love Faber, and they're great. They've worked really well with me, and they've sold more than Polygon did. They've got a bigger, they can get books into shops more easily and stuff, so. And they only offered for one book, whereas Polygon was a two-book deal. So, you know, that was the right decision. Faber and Faber are great publishers. Yeah.
Anyone else? Sina?
I have another question.
Yay.
Sorry. since Amelia Donahue was published in the US, sometimes, you know, you get the, if it should be published again in the UK, you get the opportunity to change the title.
Mm.
And since you weren't quite sure about the title, even though you love it.
Yeah.
Would you change it?
Yeah, I probably would. Yeah, because I think, I don't know, I'm just thinking, maybe Denial, maybe you could call it Denial or something.
Yeah.
That then. But yeah, I would probably make it a bit of a darker title, because I think it gives the wrong impression of the book and of who the book's about. As funny as it is, it's my husband's idea, I blame him. Yeah, I would probably change that.
Well, thank you very much, everyone, for coming. We're going to place Karen and Helen in the corner over there. Not because they've been naughty, but just right by all their books. And there's a wee table there, and we'll put two chairs behind, and they can sit there and sign. And anyone who wants to get a book signed, one of theirs, preferably, I think. You can pick up the book and talk to them right over there. And thank you so much, everyone, for coming.